Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm here with Firas Zahabi, the mastermind fighter, but also the logician, right? Also the people that know about this, but he's the man who has the ability, the theoretical and conceptual knowledge of the philosophy and logic and these things. So we're going to actually discuss randomness, because it's really a very powerful thing.
For those who don't know, I have a degree in philosophy as well. I graduated Concordia in philosophy, and this was many years ago, and for over, I would say, 20 years, I've been studying philosophy very, very closely. And, you know, I hear the modern day conversations and whatnot, and me and Muhammad become friends. We've had a lot of nice discussions as well. And there are so many great thinkers in history, you know, there's so many great thinkers, and really the knowledge is out there. It's just it's a very difficult, tedious type of knowledge to get to, because you have to read a lot of books to get to this type of knowledge. And to try to encapsulate all this, and of course you can never have more than 1% of knowledge. So today, what we want to talk about today is really a very important epistemological, excuse me, idea that's so profound that we have to put it in a simple way for people to understand.
And this is actually very important to the discourse, because like a lot of people now, especially with like atheist and theist discourse, they bring the idea of randomness. So if you ask a lot of people now, atheists or otherwise, how did the universe come into existence? They'll say, well, the universe was a random generation. It just came into existence by way of random generation. And the fine tuning that we see around us is also a random generation. Or if they don't go through that route, they'll say, well, it's random, and they'll use that in the vernacular. It's used in the vernacular kind of like to explain processes that can't be explained, really.
Right. A common misconception is, we have to understand there are three fundamental ways to know something.
Yeah.
Can we turn off the thing in the back?
Oh, yeah.
It's making noise. So there's three ways to know something, okay? You know something, I'll put it in the simplest terms possible. You can know something mathematically or logically. Mm. We can know something scientifically or empirically, okay? And we can know something intuitively, okay? So these are the three basic ways. Now, putting all that aside, all the jargon, I like to start with thought experiments, because thought experiments make complicated lessons as simple as possible, okay? Yeah. So we were talking about it earlier today, and Muhammad wanted to record it, so I think it's a great idea. Let's record it and share it. So this question I asked you before, so you already know the answer to it, okay? But the question was, if I were to flip a coin, okay, I'm gonna flip a coin. What are the odds it lands on heads?
50%.
50% is the odds it lands on heads. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The actual answer. Okay. If you want to know the truth, and an expression I like to use is capital T, not everyday truth, but the truth, the actual truth, literally speaking, the big T. You know, the actual truth, reality. The odds are one in infinity. And when we say this, people are going to be like, doesn't make any sense. It's a very normal reaction. Now, the reason why it's one in infinity is a little bit complicated, but the truth is one in infinity. Now, the reason why we say it's 50-50 is because of our prior experience with coins. It has nothing to do with logic. So, for instance, if I wiped your memory, here's a thought experiment. I wipe your memory, you have all your intelligence, you have all your faculties, and I flip a coin in front of you, but this time it's the first time you see a coin being flipped. And the coin, I flip it and it turns into a butterfly. It wouldn't be more surprising that it turned into a butterfly than if it landed on heads.
That's right.
Because you have no memory of coins.
First encounter with that.
First encounter, like for instance, a child who sees a flame for the first time.
Right.
He has no idea what's gonna happen when he touches it. As a matter of fact, you can tell him 1,000 times what's gonna happen. He still doesn't understand you. But when he touches it, now he has an experience. He has a history with flames. And this is a very profound point, because science, the scientific method we have today, is really the observations of patterns and regularities found in nature. Yeah. Patterns and regularities found in nature.
Yeah.
These patterns and regularities found in nature is what we call the science. So for instance, when I flip that coin, I do it enough times, it lands on heads, it lands on tails, it lands on heads, it lands on... You're developing a history, you're developing a... You're noticing a pattern going on. It never turned into a butterfly, it never disappeared, it always did the same thing. It either landed on tails or it landed on head, 50% of the time. Now that you've had this history with coins, you have this pattern that you figured out, you say, next time you flip it, I predict that the future will behave like the past. And this is a scientific method. Scientific method is a faith that the future will behave like the past. It's a faith. It's based on faith.
That's really profound, because it a lot of people that talk about science, right? I mean, they think that the antithesis of science is faith.
Correct.
If you don't have faith,
correct.
Science is the opposition of faith. It's knowledge. It's pure knowledge.
Right.
And what you're saying is actually, science does require some kind of faith here.
Science is a type of faith. Now, I'll give you an example for those of you who are jumping out of your seats and are furious. Me and Muhammad are lovers of science. We love science. It's just, but it's just one way of knowing something.
Yeah.
It's not the absolute truth. If you only use the scientific method, you will not get to the capital T, the truth. Okay. Like I tell Muhammad, science is popular because it fills our bellies with food, it puts gold in our safes, it allows us to conquer our enemies. It's a very practical practice. It's a very practical method of going about in life. And it's important. That's why we love science.
Yeah.
We love our smartphones. Yeah. We love our modern medicine. We're not against that.
Yeah.
But when it comes to capital truth, we have to inquire in the other realms. We have to use logic and intuition as well. It's it's a more complete understanding of what reality is. Now, if people are not interested in reality, the capital truth, just turn off this video and go watch a Kim Kardashian video maybe or something else, you know?
Yeah.
Go get a finance video, whatever. But this is a this is for people who are interested in reality as itself. And philosophers over many millennia have discussed what is reality. And it's a fascinating topic for those who are interested.
Wow.
Now, what were we saying?
About randomness. About flipping the coin now. So we flip the coin.
So we're flipping a coin. We create a pattern of regularity. Then we develop a faith that this pattern of regularity will stay up. And one very common example, one classic example, is Aristotle. A brilliant man. One of the smartest men that ever lived.
Yeah.
And he would see the sun go around the earth every day. And his ancestors told him that the sun goes around the earth in their lifetime. And that their forefathers told them that the sun goes around the earth. And that was a scientific
observation
found in nature, done by countless people. He said, look, the sun goes around the earth, it's a fact. Fast forward many years later, some philosophers and thinkers started saying, no, wait a second, we object. We think it's the earth going around the sun. Turns out it's an optical illusion. Those thinkers were correct. Galileo and the bunch. There's actually many great thinkers in history who suggested that maybe the earth is going around the sun. It's the opposite. It's just an optical illusion. Regardless, a scientific fact was overturned. Now, scientific facts are overturned throughout history. Why? Optical illusions, faulty patterns. We made a mistake. We thought a pattern was such and it wasn't. Like, for instance, we used to think that all flamingos are pink. And then we went to Australia and we found black flamingos, and we turned out, hey, flamingos are pink because of the food that they eat. Another scientific fact overturned. A scientific fact can never actually literally be a fact as people commonly understand the word fact. Okay, a fact is what the consensus is, what the experts today agree upon. That is a scientific fact. It's not the same as a mathematical fact.
It's like the problem of induction comes into it.
Yeah, the problem of induction. So a fact in science is really a hypothesis, a very agreed upon hypothesis. Now, this is not an attack on science. Again, we love science, okay? Nothing wrong with science. Science is a beautiful thing. We're just being honest about science and what are its strengths and weaknesses. Is science absolute? Meaning, if I follow the scientific method, I will know the reality of the world as it is. What is your opinion on this?
Well, because of the problem of induction. So, as you've outlined correctly here, the problem of induction indicates that with the flamingo example, I think David Hume used the swan example. It's like, it's not possible.
Right, swan, flamingo, etc.
Yeah, so the idea of like having all of the sample group. The sample group can't be fully represented. And for that reason, we cannot assume that everything can be analyzed or and generalized.
Right.
That's one thing. And the other thing is that, like you were saying, kind of links into what you were saying, David Hume also mentioned this point, which is the idea of history repeating itself. We have to have the faith in that. Correct. And that's a presupposition in all of science. And you always have to have that faith.
Yeah, and David Hume was very open about it. He's a phenomenal philosopher. He said, look, science is the faith that the history will repeat itself, that the future will behave like the past. If the future, for whatever reason, doesn't behave like the past, You know, and you know, Karl Popper, he did a beautiful experiment to try to fix this issue. Okay, maybe that we're sidetracking. We want to talk about randomness, but we all know Karl Popper created falsification. For those of you out there who are familiar with Karl Popper, but even that doesn't get around the problem. It makes it better. It brings us closer to the truth, but it doesn't get around the problem. So science is not absolute. Okay, so that's number one.
Yeah.
Do scientists like Richard Dawkins and Lawrence Krauss, do they know this? They know it, but they, in my opinion, from hearing them talk, they don't understand deduction and intuition. They don't understand the other types of logic. And I've heard them say very illogical things. And David Berlinsky, a philosopher, a PhD, when he commented on Richard Dawkins, he says, look, Richard Dawkins is a crummy philosopher, to use his words. And he even said he's a reptile of a human being. You know what I mean? And David Berlinsky is a PhD in mathematics and philosophy. He understands logic and reason, and he understands science very well.
Yeah.
Okay? He's a very learned man, and I hold him to be much more learned than a Richard Dawkins.
Mm-hmm.
Like Kant says, and this is Kant's word, not my words. He says, look, sciences are not necessarily smart. They follow a formula. They follow a method. Yes, they're smart to interpret the data, etc. The average physicist's IQ is about 130.
Really?
Yeah, the average physicist's IQ is 130. Now, this is
average.
It's smart. No. 130 is very high. 130 is very high. 132 is genius. Okay, they're smart.
Oh, right.
Don't get me wrong. They're smart people. But if we're talking about the giants of intelligence, okay, they were, you know, we have some people we estimate by consensus, and the psychologists will estimate they're 200. Or 170 or 160, this is another world, okay? Wow. 140 is another world, 150 is another world, and there are people today alive that score 190. I mean, this is another world of IQ, but IQ is not necessarily... IQ, like I was telling you earlier today, IQ would be like your athleticism. Doesn't mean the best athlete is the best fighter or the best boxer. He has the potential to be really good at the sport. But... you could be a lesser athlete and have a better jiu-jitsu or wrestling ability than a better athlete. It happens all the time, okay? So let's not put IQ above all. It's not. It's a factor, and many studies have proven that over and over again. But I don't want to go into a tangent. We're talking about randomness. Randomness, I think, is the most misunderstood concept in the history of Western science.
Okay.
And a man by the name of Laplace, I believe it was Jean-Pierre Laplace, he was a physicist in the time of Sir Isaac Newton. He was a successor to Sir Isaac Newton. Sir Isaac Newton completely outshined him. We all know that name, Sir Isaac Newton. But Laplace did some phenomenal work. But he was just the Scottie Pippen of Michael Jordan. You know, Scottie Pippen was great. But Michael Jordan was just the greatest of all time.
Right.
Okay, and we can argue that, quite easily actually we can argue, that Isaac Newton was the greatest scientist of all time. Scientist of all time. Not philosopher, but scientist. And Laplace was just outshined, it just so happened to be, okay? And Laplace explained something so wonderful, so deep, so profound, that it bears mentioning in this video. He says, look at a billiard ball table. Look at the balls on a pool table. You guys say pool here?
Yeah.
Billiard balls, pool? Okay. So I break the billiard balls, and there are two people watching the break. One is a physicist, and one is an everyday person. And the everyday person said, look, I'm going to break it. The balls are going to scatter randomly. The physicist is going to say, no. Tell me how you're going to hit it, at what angle, at what force, and I'll tell you where every ball is going to be. There's nothing random about this. And when you tell him, well, I'm going to hit it this hard, at this angle, he'll take that table. Laplace will take that table. The physicist will take that table. He'll turn it to a mathematical equation. And then he will tell you where every single ball is going to be on the table with perfect accuracy, except with a tiny error. He'll be off by a very small margin. And Laplace says, I'll be off by a very small margin only because I have to round up the numbers. I have to round off the numbers. He says, I don't have a divine calculator. If I had a divine calculator and I didn't round up,
everything would be perfect.
I would tell you exactly to the... smallest degree exactly where each ball is going to land. Now why? He's going to calculate the friction of the table. He's going to calculate the ball, the weight of the ball. He's going to calculate the angle. He's going to calculate the density of the pool bands, the bands. He's going to calculate everything. He's going to turn it into mathematics. And those mathematics are sure. There's nothing unsure. And Laplace says, give me an atom in your hand. Give me its coordinates and its velocity. And I'll tell you where it's going to be in 5 years from now. Now, many of you might be like, oh, this makes no sense. It's perfectly sensible. If you understand physics, you understand that he is saying something 100% true.
Mm. So what you're saying here is that randomness is just an excuse for people to describe something which they can't explain.
When something is too chaotic for us, meaning we cannot compute all the factors, we use an expression saying randomness.
Mm.
You know how they say, well, when somebody says randomness, what they're really saying is, look, I am not able to compute all this information. I have lost track of all the factors.
Mm.
But the way I express that is I say the word randomness.
Mm.
Laplace said when God sees the world, he doesn't see any randomness, obviously.
Yeah.
God sees the future, past, and present at once. He knows every single... And he was saying this because if you understand the divine mind, obviously, nothing is random. There would be no randomness. So randomness is a personal experience and a reflection of our ignorance.
Mm.
So for instance, two people are watching the pool balls be hit.
Yes.
One of them is a physicist. He's telling you, look, the ball is going to land right here.
Yes.
The layman is telling you, no, it's going to randomly scatter all over. Which one is correct? The physicist is correct.
Mm.
The layman is incorrect, but he believes there's a randomness to the break.
Only because they don't understand the pattern.
Only because of ignorance. So anytime we say randomness...
You don't understand the pattern.
See, I believe that certain things happen in the universe, yes, but not at random. I don't accept randomness.
Mm.
Randomness is just you throwing in the towel saying, look, I cannot compute.
Mm.
Well, randomness is an illusion. It's a figment of the imagination. Not according to me, according to Laplace and physicists who turned philosophers. I believe if you could reach a certain level of reflection on physics, that you become a philosopher. That's what a PhD is supposed to be. You reach this level where now you're not just thinking about the particulars, you are thinking about what we call the universals. Long story short, there is no such thing as randomness. If it's natural selection by means of random mutation, I disagree. If you tell me it's natural selection by means of mutation, I possibly agree if you can prove me that. But randomness, I cannot agree. So this brings us to, what would a random world really look like? We go back to the coin experience.
Okay, this is interesting. Yeah, so what you're saying here, just to kind of summarize, tell me if I've got this right.
Go ahead.
What you're saying here is that, with the whole pool example, that if a layman saw what was going on, right, they would see that. They would see that as seemingly a random experiment, right? Because they're just seeing things moving around in a haphazard way, and they're computing that as something they can't comprehend or otherwise wouldn't be able to anticipate in a normal situation.
Mm-hmm.
And so they've labeled that as random. But what you're saying is, now, if you think about it, everything does have a measurement and has a pattern. And just because we don't understand that measurement or that pattern or that law, you could even say, it doesn't mean that that would be random. Is that?
I could say you could understand it, but you're not able to compute it. You don't have a divine calculator.
Right.
You're not able to make the equations.
Yeah.
Because they're too complicated and there's too many things to factor in.
Yeah.
Mm. You might understand the laws of physics thoroughly, but there's just too much information for you to compute.
Yeah.
So if I make the universe into a billiard ball table, now it's controllable and now you can compute.
Yeah.
Now, what Laplace was saying is, look, all the chemicals in your brain, the chemical reactions, your thoughts, these are all little billiard balls, so to speak. It's an expression we use.
Yeah.
It's matter pushing on matter. They say in physics, that the causal line is complete. What does it mean that the causal line is complete?
Mm.
Meaning that everything that happens in physics, everything that happens in the world you're living in today, was little tiny billiard balls, so to speak, hitting one another. This is an expression, okay, we use. Is that okay? Mm. It's to say that...
It's an interesting way of putting it.
Yes, it's to say that the dominoes... Let's say you have 100 dominoes.
Right.
And you number the dominoes 1 to 100.
Yes.
And then you saw a gap. So domino 55, 56, 57 is missing. Mm. And you knock down domino 1 and it hits domino 54.
Yeah.
And then domino
58
falls over. Mm. And there was a gap.
Mm.
They're saying there's no such gap. The dominoes are perfect. We can compute. There's nothing mysterious about what's going on.
Mm.
Physics is there. We can read the situation clearly.
Mm.
There is, that's what Laplace was saying. There is no randomness whatsoever. The dominoes are there. We can calculate them. The reason we cannot calculate them, we cannot calculate the weather or whatnot, is because it's too complex for us to compute all the factors.
Mm.
Hypothetically, theoretically, it is 100% possible.
Mm.
So
you were asking about the world if it was actually random.
If it was what would it look actually like? Random.
Right. Yeah, so.
And I flipped that coin.
Yeah.
One time it would turn into a butterfly. Mm. One time it would turn into a bird. One time it would turn into an ice cube. One time it would vanish. It would act randomly.
Completely haphazardly.
That would be true randomness. Mm. The fact that it lands on... they make little robots, you know, to prove this.
Mm.
I sent you this video once upon a time. I don't know if you remember. There's actual robots that can flip a coin with 100% accuracy. Did you know that?
Well, they flip it and what happens?
They flip a coin and you could set the robot to flip the coin to heads or tails. And it'll flip it 30, 40 times in the air. And they know, the machine knows how much the coin weighs. It knows the density of the air.
And it knows how to bring it
on. It throws the coin in the air. And the coin will land on heads 100% of the time. Not 99.9.
Wow.
These machines exist.
Mm.
It was to prove the Laplacian theory.
Mm.
That look, these robots are flipping coins and these coins are landing on heads, not 99.9.
Mm. 100% of the time.
100%.
Wow.
Now, what does this mean? This means
something. What are the implications of this then?
It's huge. The implications are huge.
Yeah.
The implications are that randomness does not exist. It is a figment of your imagination.
So what instead exists?
What, order. What is the opposite of randomness?
Order.
So you tell me. Order.
Okay.
There's nothing but order.
So are you saying that there are laws that are ordered and predetermined,
look,
and stated in the universe?
Look, every pattern in the world, every scientific law. Let me ask you this question. Can you put science in a test tube?
No.
You cannot put science in a test tube. Science is not a thing, a material thing, right? It's something, a construct of the mind.
Mm.
When you look at the universe and you talk about science, you're talking about an activity inside your mind.
Yeah.
You're talking about, because you cannot weigh science, you cannot hold science, you cannot scientifically test science, the scientific method, we cannot scientifically test it. It is a mental construct, it's a type of thinking.
Mm.
When you say science, you are admitting to order. You're saying, look, I see an order.
Mm.
If you said, I don't believe in science, you would be saying, I don't see an order.
Mm.
I see no patterns and I see no regularities in nature. I see pure randomness. Now, if me and you lived in a universe that every time you pushed the brake in your car, the car would do anything but brake. It would do a random activity. Mm. And every time you'd say a word, that word would come out completely different than the time before. And everything was random. You would say, look, I see no science. You wouldn't know nothing about science.
Yeah.
That would be a truly unscientific world.
Yeah,
you would have no concept of science. Could you imagine a world like this?
No.
It's a little bit of the Alice in Wonderland, you know?
Yeah.
Things are popping in and out of existence and they're trying to create some type of randomness, true randomness in that story. It's,
wow.
It's a bit of a little bit of randomness.
Well, I never
right?
thought about that when I was a kid looking over there.
There is something special to Alice in Wonderland. A story for another day.
Yeah.
Could you picture a truly random world where things pop in and out of existence? Like for instance, when they discovered the quantum world and they reported it to Einstein, he famously said,
God doesn't play dice
with the universe.
With the
universe. He was telling them, look, it seems random, but it is not. Once we learn more about quantum physics, it won't. You're saying something so preposterous.
Mm.
God doesn't play dice with the universe. Mm. There is no dice in the universe. The dice is just a reflection of your ignorance. Now, if I roll a dice, that's a great example. If you told me exactly at what force and how you started with the dice, if I had all the information, I turned it to math, I could tell you exactly how the dice is going to land. There is no randomness.
So, how does this link to the whole theism, atheism, theism debate?
Well, this is the nucleus of the matter.
Right.
Picture me a random world. Before we answer that question, picture me a random.
So it would be one that you
describe
just
me one.
So one, maybe one that doesn't even exist, or one that's
it doesn't
in.
Exist. But
yeah.
Picture one. Try it.
So maybe things are just popping in and out of existence.
Okay. Give me an example.
Like you say, so if, for example...
It's hard to envision.
Yeah, it's just something which... Things are moving all the time, just, I don't know.
It's very hard to envision.
Yeah, there would be no, like...
You wouldn't even be able to talk in a truly random
yeah.
world. There would be no conversation because patterns and regularities. Language is patterns and regularities. Everything is patterns and regularities.
Mm.
Your whole existence, you would go mad if you didn't have patterns and regularities. These patterns and regularities are the opposite of randomness.
Mm.
When they say the world came to be, that becomes now we're starting to deduce now, we're creating deduction. When the world became to be, they say, look, there are so many universes that this one landed the way it is.
Yeah.
At random, they say.
Mm.
This universe didn't land at random. It landed exactly, precisely, because of patterns and regularities.
Mm.
This entails heavily God. It does entail God. It basically says, look, God created order in the universe. This is what is known as top down, not bottom up. Bottom up is by trial and error. Top down is by design. Now, I don't hold the same views as the mainstream design believers.
Mm.
Okay, I maybe should not have used that word because people are going to associate me with the people who, the way I see, if you look at the Quran, for instance, there's some beautiful verses.
Yeah,
some beautiful, beautiful, beautiful verses that I don't know in Arabic, and I wish I could do them justice and tell you them properly. But God says, the night and the day, the pattern of night and day, that's a sign for those who think.
Mm.
That pattern, the sun, if it was random, it would blink in and out of existence, it would change temperature, it would change color, it would do all sorts of crazy things.
Mm.
It's not, it follows an exact measurement.
Exactly what the Quran says.
Exactly what the Quran says. This measurement,
the sun and the moon follow an exact measure, really. Yeah.
To say it's random is to make yourself the center of the universe.
Wow. Yeah.
Because you're seeing the world through your own eyes, and you're being self-centered. You're making the world all about me. I'm the center of my universe. It's a type of egoism.
Wow.
The world, I'm the measure of all things. Like there was the sophists. They say man is the measure of all things.
Mm.
This in Islam is the polar opposite of Islam.
Mm.
I would tell you. Man is not the measure of all things.
Mm.
The truth is above man.
Mm.
So anyway, Socrates had a great dialogue in the book of Gorgias with the sophists, and he kind of shut them down. He kind of gave them, in my opinion, the death blow. Man is not the measure of all things.
Mm.
There is an independent truth outside of man. Agree to it or not, there's a truth.
Mm.
So Socrates does it beautifully in the book of Gorgias. I won't go into it, maybe later if we have time, because this would be a tangent. Okay,
yeah.
But there is no randomness. There are only patterns and regularities. These patterns and regularities are not logical in any way. They're not necessary in any way. They're not necessary in any way.
There's no logical reason for them to exist in the way they do.
There is no logical reason for them to exist whatsoever.
And
if there was a logical reason,
when
I flip the coin in front of your eyes, you would know before you've ever experienced coin. You would know. You would say, "Look, I've deduced."
Yeah.
I've deduced. We don't deduce the our experiences. We discover our experiences. It's a bit complicated. It's a bit sticky. But if you meditate on, you think about it, you'll realize there's no such thing as randomness. And the only thing left is order.
Yeah.
When you look at science, science is not out there.
Mm.
Science is an internal experience. You are noticing these patterns and regularities. Now, a scientist will say, no, look, there were so many Earths out there.
Mm.
At random, he'll throw that word in.
Mm.
And one of them so happened to be close enough to the sun, it didn't burn, but close enough that it didn't freeze. Far enough away that it didn't burn, close enough that it didn't freeze. I will agree that there are maybe many Earths.
Mm.
Some were too close, some were too far. And one of them was the Goldilocks, right? The right amount. But I won't agree that it was random. I will agree, like Leibniz would say. Again, none of these ideas are mine, okay? I don't want to take any, please don't. If you agree with me, don't give me any credit. And you disagree with me, please know you're disagreeing with the giants of philosophy and science.
Mm.
Leibniz would tell you, this is, Leibniz is often in the top five of the greatest IQs of all time, and all the lists of the consensus. He's the man who invented, who discovered calculus and the binary code, your computer, this phone. It's all working because of Leibniz. Okay, he's a brilliant, brilliant human being, brilliant philosopher. We'll talk about him many times in our discussions. He said, look, this world is the perfect world. Why? I won't get into it completely. But he's saying, look, there could not have been, this world was made this way. It was contingent. And he was a theist. Okay, he had a great argument for the
contingency argument.
Contingent. Yes, it's contingent, but because God made it this way, it's the it's not a random effect. These patterns and regularities are not random. They're illogical. They're completely illogical. There is no logic to them.
There's no logical way of explaining why they exist even.
There is no, that's a better way to say it. Maybe Allah has his own logic for how he created the world. But there is no way of deducing them logically. It's impossible. Randomness is a figment of your imagination, because if I increased your knowledge, randomness would disappear.
So the most worthwhile explanation is to say that this universe had these laws placed within them by a higher metaphysical agency.
These laws don't exist. They're patterns and regularities, and we project laws. These laws are just our way of talking, are just our way of bookmarking the patterns.
All right, yeah. But the patterns exist.
I'll give you a for instance. Isaac Newton, one of the most brilliant men in history, he said, look, here are the three laws of motions. I've discovered them. Turns out they're wrong. Did you guys know that? His theories on gravity were wrong. He thought gravity was a pulling force.
Yeah.
Gravity is a pushing force. Einstein. And one day we'll discuss how Einstein figured that out with a thought experiment. We're doing a thought experiment. Einstein, one of the great kings of thought experiments.
Yeah.
How he figured out, it's a beautiful story, how he figured out that gravity is a pushing force, not a pulling force. He outdid Isaac Newton. When they asked him, how do you feel to have outdone Isaac Newton? You know, he gave a beautiful answer. He said, if I see far, it's because I stand on the shoulders of giants. Meaning, Sir Isaac Newton's work paved the way for my work. Because Isaac Newton was wrong about gravity. We still use, as physicists still use the three laws of motion because they're so useful. However, they're not fundamentally true. Another scientific fact that we had to revisit. Nothing wrong with it. I praise the man. He's a brilliant man. However, these laws of physics were just bookmarks.
Yeah.
For patterns and regularities. However, his explanations for patterns and regularities were wrong. They were illusionary. Einstein figured out the true cause, the seemingly true. It's kind of like the sun going around the earth. There was an illusion there, and Einstein proved it. Okay, he proved it with a thought experiment. He said, "What if the sun disappears?"
What happened to Einstein and prove something.
Exactly. Yeah. So these are the laws of physics are just bookmarks. They're just our way of saying, look, here are these patterns. Let's give it a name. Let's give it a label.
Would you say also they indicate the existence of a higher metaphysical being?
Absolutely.
Well?
It's the greatest egocentric, it's the greatest egotistical statement to say something is random.
Wow.
Why? Because you're saying that the world is as how I see it. And because my ignorance is here, the world's here. I cannot see any further. A great question I want to ask you. Is the highest mountain you've ever seen? This is a great question. I'm forgetting now who said it. It's such a beautiful question. Is the highest mountain you've ever seen, Muhammad Hijab, the highest mountain that exists?
No.
How do you know that?
Well,
you can imagine possibly, you know that your experiences are not the end all be all. It's a very humble answer.
Yeah.
To say, you know what, maybe not. But the man who says, the highest mountain I've seen is the highest mountain there is. He's taking an egocentric position. He's saying, I'm the measure of truth.
Right. That's a really good way of putting it.
It is a beautiful way. When somebody tells you something is random and they refuse to let go of randomness, they're telling you, look, don't tell me I'm ignorant. It's a personal issue. And philosophy, why people don't like philosophy. And I remember reading one of my textbooks. He was saying, look, philosophy is you looking in the mirror. And he was saying, if you don't want to know that you're ugly, don't go look in the river. It's an ancient saying. Don't go look in the river. That's how people used to see their reflections. If you want to believe you're beautiful, don't look in the river, because when you look in the river, you can see your reflection. In philosophy, when you study philosophy, you realize how little you know. No, Socrates said it so well. Knowledge is to know the extent of your own ignorance. Randomness is a reflection of my ignorance. I know that randomness, when I see something randomness, I know it's not the truth, capital T. It's my level. The highest mountain that I've seen is not necessarily the highest mountain. You know, the highest mountain we have observed as a human species is on Mars. It's bigger than the state of Texas. So if you stood on the highest mountain on earth and you say, proclaim this to be the highest mountain, you'd be wrong. We know of a higher, much higher mountain. They say that mountain is so high, if you were standing on it, you wouldn't know you're on the mountain. So randomness is a figment of your imagination. All we know is order. And the story about the multiverse would still not escape the problem. You know, some people say, Oh, there's a multiverse.
Mm.
You still have not understood determinism. Determinism, if there was a multiverse, then there is one multiverse. It would never change. We can never escape determinism. We will do a video, I'm sure, one day on determinism.
Yeah.
Determinism in philosophy is the one thing we all agree on. I don't care who you are. Mm. Atheist, theist, logician. We all agree on determinism. And in philosophy, we say you either agree with determinism or you don't understand it. Mm. That's the two positions. Mm. When I would go to school, some people would be upset with determinism, that there's no randomness, etc. People would be furious. They don't understand. They would fail. The teacher would give you a zero. You didn't understand. Mm. Determinism is a very important topic. In Islam, people, Muslims might not know this, we are hard determinists in Islam. It's hardcore determinism.
We have that balance between free will and determinism.
It's what Hegel would call an apparent contradiction.
Yeah.
Now, you know what, me, we'll talk about anything you want.
Okay? Yeah.
But listen, determinism, even when you move your own hand, physics will explain how you moved your own hand. Remember, we said the causal line is complete. Physics tells us that every action in the history of the world is due to two things.
Mm.
Your genetics and your environment.
What about the mind?
We'll get to that after.
Mm.
It's a very interesting question. Very interesting question.
Mm.
But to keep things super simple,
mm.
if I observe every behavior you've ever done, every action, it's a result of two things. Your genetics and your environment. So for instance, keep it really simple here, simple as possible. You go in a restaurant, there are two flavors, vanilla or chocolate. Go ahead, choose.
Banana.
Choose a flavor.
Kind of ask the chef to make me something. No?
No. Vanilla or chocolate?
Fine, I have vanilla.
Vanilla, okay.
Yeah.
Why did you choose vanilla?
Two choices and I just chose one of them.
Okay, you just chose one of them. Well, yeah. I'll tell you, there's an explanation. You chose vanilla because your taste buds, they have a chemical reaction that's more pleasurable than when your taste buds touch chocolate.
Yeah.
And they're this way because of your genetics. And your genetics, you didn't choose them. Hence, you didn't choose vanilla. Your genetics chose for you because you always follow your greatest desire and you have no choice in the matter. Every human being always follows their greatest desire and they don't choose what their greatest desire is.
Mm.
Now, maybe you would have chose strawberry, but your environment only allowed you two choices.
Right.
And now we trace back the choice to environment.
Mm.
It's always nature or nurture, nature or nurture. And then in science and in philosophy, we have something called epiphenomenalism. Epiphenomenalism means that because of determinism, this little example I gave you, because of Laplace, the billiard ball theory, because everything is pushing everything else, physics is a causal chain.
Yeah.
And your genetics were given to you because of your parents, you didn't choose your parents, and so on and so forth. And you were born in this country, and this is your environment, and you didn't choose your environment.
Mm.
All these things are out of your control, and your behavior is based on these two things, and these two things are out of your control, therefore your behavior is out of your control.
Yeah.
Yet, in epiphenomenalism, they tell you when you reach for a glass of water, they say your desire to reach for a glass, your will, you know, your free will, the thing you're telling me about free will, when you reach for it, it was irrelevant. We knew you were going to reach for that glass of water. We could calculate, if we could look into your mind and calculate all those billiard balls, we can know your genetics. One day we'll compute your genetics.
Mm.
We'll say, Muhammad Hijab's going to walk in this restaurant at 5 o'clock. He's going to sit here. He's going to ask for a different flavor. We're going to tell him no, and he's going to end up choosing vanilla. Mm. We could predict everything. And it would be right. Now, where does that leave free will? Because Leibniz said, that contradicts my experience. I'm not this robot. Because it would be basically you're a robot.
Well, that life is a roller coaster kind of thing. Like,
you're on a track.
Yeah.
But what physics is saying is, look, Muhammad Hijab, you are exactly like a robot. If we know your algorithm, we know exactly what decisions you will make. Anything we would say is randomness is really truly a limit of our thought ability to think, to compute. If we had a divine calculator, we would know exactly everything. Okay. But when I sit down, I feel like I'm having a choice. Now, how do I know that I feel like I'm having a choice? What method am I using? Am I using a scientific method, a logical method, meaning mathematics, or am I using intuition?
Intuition?
Intuition. I feel like this story you just gave me is BS. I don't believe this robot theory. You know what? I chose vanilla. And my intuition is just as true, or if not, it's actually more true. I'm more confident because I'm feeling it directly. All your science is an interpretation of patterns and regularities. You have a faith-based
system
that, that the history, the future will behave like the past. How did Leibniz melt these two together? He said, look, Hegel would say that's an apparent contradiction. When things seem they cannot be reconciled, but they can be. It seems it cannot be reconciled.
But it can be.
But they can be. So Leibniz, of course, Leibniz comes to the rescue quite often in history and philosophy. Many great thinkers did. I don't want to just give Leibniz as an example. Leibniz coined it beautifully. And I always like to quote the person who coined it very beautifully. Because, you know, in Islam, we say, you're determined.
Yeah.
The Sahaba even asked the Prophet, if we're determined, why? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, amilu, do. You know, do, make action. Man asked him, should I tie my camel or should I just Allah take care of it? What do you say?
Let me
what was
tie
that?
It
and then Allah take care of it. There was a harmony.
Yeah.
There was a harmony.
Yeah.
So Leibniz says this, he says, look, picture two trains, right? They're on twin tracks. They're not connected together at all. They're just synchronized.
Yeah.
They're operating independently, but they're synchronized. Okay, so these two trains, if you looked at them from a bird's eye view, you would think they're connected. You get closer to them and you see, no, they're not connected. They're in a harmony together. Leibniz says this, look, when I reach for a glass of water and I drink it, Leibniz says, my will, my this part of my body that's not part of the machine, your consciousness is not part of the machine. Remember we talked about in the other video about if I walked around in your brain, I would see all the machinery of your brain, but I wouldn't see your consciousness. I wouldn't see your first person experience.
Yeah.
I wouldn't see all the thoughts you have. I wouldn't see the what it is to be you. That you only know it intuitively. We don't know that scientifically. He said, look, that intuition, that part of mine, that spirit, that consciousness, that immaterial part of me, that metaphysical part of me, is in harmony. My arm is moving. And my will, which is not moving my arm, they're just in harmony.
They're in harmony.
And I bring that water and I drink it. Or I eat that ice cream or whatever you did. He says that harmony, we ask him, well, how does this harmony come about? He says, God. God basically is saying to you, he took the greatest pool shot in history.
Right, okay.
Everything is harmony. Now, in Quran, in Islam, this is perfect. Because exactly you can't do anything outside the will of Allah.
Yeah. But at the same time, there is the whole idea of free will as well.
There's the idea of free will.
Yes.
But there's a condition.
Yes, it has to be through will.
If I go to shoot you and the gun jams, you say Qadr Allah.
Yeah, that's right.
My will was to kill you.
Yes.
But Allah didn't will it. There wasn't the harmony.
But
yet still no contradiction.
Yeah.
Contradictions cannot exist.
Yes.
That's how we know truth exists. People say our truth is relative. No. If truth was relative, contradictions would exist. We know contradictions do not
exist. That's an interesting refutation of relativity.
Absolutely. Listen, and one day we'll do a video on just the book of Gorgias from Plato.
Yeah? I know you like Plato and especially ancient Greece. Well, look, I think this is a lot to think about.
It is a lot, but I don't want to leave you off the hook just yet.
Yes, go on.
I want to cap it off. Okay?
Go on.
We've been talking for hours, okay? This is like hour, we're about 45 minutes in now.
Yeah.
This is like hour 7 for us, okay? Me and him were hanging out all day.
Yeah.
I'll give you that example, the pool example. Okay, this is more of a theology now.
Okay.
When people say Islam is peace, Islam is peace, Islam is peace. I'll tell you, from what I understand, again, my knowledge of Islam is limited, correct me.
Okay.
But from somebody who studied philosophy for 20 years and now I'm studying Islam more, I'm seeing some very profound statements that I wonder if you can correct me. Okay. If this is my interpretation, maybe it's completely wrong. But Islam is a practice, it's a verb, right? Somebody's Islam could be better than another's or practice better than another. It's a verb, it's a practice.
Yeah, submission, yeah.
It's a submission, right? It's actually very intriguing, the name submission. Because I'll give you this example. Imagine you're standing by a pool. And I push you in the pool, and you're angry because you're dressed in your clothes, and you're in the pool, and you're angry.
I've got a video like that online as well.
So you're angry. I push you in the pool. Yeah. I'm laughing, and you're angry. And now you're standing by the pool again on another day. And you don't know I'm behind you, and I'm about to push you in. And as I'm pushing you in, you are jumping in.
At the same time.
There was a synchrony. a harmony. And you land in the pool, and I think I pushed you, and you jumped in voluntarily, and there's a harmony.
Amazing, amazing, yeah.
There's a harmony there. Right. Our wills were in tune.
Wow, wow.
Are you at peace now in this scenario?
Yes, amazing.
The first scenario, not at peace. The second scenario, at peace.
Mm-hmm.
Now, before I let you go, I'm going to tell you a story about Kitty Byron. Why I believe that if you have a trust in Allah, you accept the dunya as it is. You accept your destiny as it is.
Mm.
You have a peace because you have a trust. Any type of turmoil is being at odds with the will of God. Mm. You don't accept the world as it is. You don't accept your looks as they are, your intelligence as they are, your potential as it is, your situation as it is. You're angry. You're not in harmony. So there's a woman named Kitty Byron, and I'm using her as an example because she's a great bridge from East and West. She was a secular person, a Western thinker. I believe she's even English, if I remember correctly. Right. Or American English. Kitty Byron. Very, very intriguing person. She's considered to be an enlightened being, though.
Yeah.
They consider her like the Buddhist. They consider her to be enlightened.
Really?
Yeah. So she said that she was going to the madhouse. She was committed. Because her life was just, she had depression. And then one day she said she had an epiphany. She writes books now. She helps people all over the world. She's a very famous speaker and writer. Very famous. She helps people all sorts of problems. She says, look, one day I came to the conclusion that, you know what, there's God's business and there's my business, and I'm never going to object to God's business again.
Yeah.
So she went back home and she saw her kids' socks on the floor, she says, and she, for years she fought with them to pick up their socks. Now she said, you know what, I'm just going to pick it up. And if her daughter gave her bad news, it wasn't bad news. She didn't interpret it as bad news. Now this is very stoic of her, you know. That's a story for another day. And she became happy and joyful. And she gives you the story about how her grandson once upon a time was dying in her arms, and she didn't let the fact that he's dying spoil it. She said, look, if he lives or dies, that's God's business. The medics are doing what they can.
They can do. Wow. Yeah.
I won't let this rob me of my moment I have with him, whether I have 50 years with him or 10 years.
It shows you the power this whole, this whole philosophy has on you, or this whole theology, this whole precept has. It makes you, like you said in another video, it makes you much more like willing to give the world or take from the world, because you realize that there is a plan. There's a bigger plan.
There is a plan, but there was a submission on her part.
Yeah.
She yielded to God's business. She said, look, God's business, I'll never argue with you again. I'll never go against the grain again. If something, a calamity happens tomorrow, I will not interpret it as a calamity.
Wow.
I refuse to.
Wow.
It's your, you did this, it's out of my control. So this is it. Whatever's in your control, do it. Be in harmony. Whatever's out of your control, don't say you like it or you dislike it. Be in harmony with it and accept it. This is what I understand from what I've understood myself and understood, you know, and again, I'm a very beginner. This makes why I would say it's the name Islam. It's one, maybe one, it makes sense. It's a submission to the will. There must be a synchrony, a yielding, I should say, a yielding. And again, this is very complicated topics, and we'll...
I think that that last pool example, I think both examples, Leibniz's example and the pools, if you think about them, you might not have understood them straight away, but if you think about them with a little bit of thought and kind of let it mature and ferment in your mind a little bit, I think it will actually have a real resonating effect on you. So do think about it. It's really interesting how to put the two things together, kind of like free will and determinism, and how it can seem like an apparent contradiction, but when you do put them together, it can become very, very powerful. But for
and
us,
and if you object to any of these ideas, show us one instance of true randomness.
Oh yeah, and that's another.
That'll be
point
great.
As well.
I would love to. I would love to learn.
Yeah, that'll
if
be
somebody
excellent.
Can show one example
of actual randomness.
Of actual randomness.
Yeah.
That's not a reflection of our ignorance. Nobody in history has done it so far. Maybe somebody out there will. Who knows? I personally believe it's logically impossible.
Yeah.
But again, I've made mistakes in the past, and I'm sure.
Yeah, you know, I'm sure they're gonna leave their comments and definitely try and engage with us. But thanks so much for coming.
it's a pleasure.
We did this in the car this time.
Yeah.
But we haven't had the effects and the cameras and stuff like that. So hopefully you did enjoy the video. Make sure that you do subscribe to Firas's channel. He's also, as you know, a mastermind in the fight game, and he does breakdowns of different videos, training videos, nutrition, motivational videos. You go into lots of different things. As you can see, he's an all-rounder, and now of course he's coming in with into these discussions as well, so you can see that he has got that all-roundedness and knowledge. So if you subscribe to TriStar Gym, it's called, isn't it?
TriStar Gym channel.
Yeah.
There's no philosophy there. It's mostly training and lifestyle and martial arts, etc.
Yeah, that would be good for your body and your mind a little bit as well. And obviously, this channel will try and do a bit of soul, a bit of mind, and sometimes from time to time a little body as well. Why not? Yeah. Anyways, guys, see you later. I'll see you. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.